Welcome to Horror Stories Fanatics. If you enjoy this type of content, then subscribe and hit the bell icon so you never miss out on any of our latest and greatest uploads. During the 1980s, the city of Pennsylvania became home to three notorious serial killers. The first, Gary Heidnik, aka the Frankfurt Slasher, who murdered seven people and held several more women in a torture chamber, one he retrofitted out of his North Marshall Street home's basement. Then, a man named Leonard Christopher was arrested after an escaped victim turned eyewitness linked the killer to at least seven murders of females in the Frankfurt area. Finally, the third. During the summer of 1987, police responded to complaints of residents living at a decrepit apartment complex in North Philadelphia. Behind a door, nailed shut by its renter, women's decomposing bodies were found on that sweltering day. There is no such thing as one murder more heinous than the next. Whenever life is stolen, degrees of less tolerable are impossible to measure. We consider a murder, shake our heads in disbelief, and wonder how and why. What sorts of monsters are capable of stealing life? Who does this? Is it evil? A bondage to darkness that takes over and possesses and creates literal boogeymen? Perhaps, certainly, it is worthy of examination. Sometimes, we can actually look at a murderer and see the missing links in his character and wonder to ourselves how someone, somewhere along the way, did not point a finger and say, "Hey, someone needs to intervene here. We've got some wrong behavior going on over there." When researchers look back at infamous serial killer Jeffrey Dahmer, a background of abuse to animals and other pathological cruelty is uncovered. Charles Manson spent most of his youth in reformatory. Conversely, Ted Bundy, who murdered at least two dozen women, had no criminal background. He was able to elude suspicion all of his life, all the while harboring obsessive sexual fantasy. Harrison Graham could not be categorized into any of these categories. He was not cruel to animals. He was not in and out of youth camps, nor did he charm people with his courtesy and flirtations. Nevertheless, he was a red flag waving high in the street, begging for supervision, crisis intervention, and intervention in the most major way. Harrison Frank Graham's story starts in a troubled home that drove him out onto the streets where he felt loved. He became a prostitute, and his pimp was also his lover. Graham used drugs and eventually started selling them to boost his finances. When Graham was a teenager, his mother had some spiritual awakening and dragged him back to the house away from the streets, telling him how immoral his lifestyle was. Graham, as an adult, was well-liked by his neighbors. They described him as easygoing. The women he was around in the building were not afraid of him at all, so much so, they asked him to do handiwork for them. The Cookie Monster and the Serial Killer. A killer's strange insanity defense involved the beloved puppet. Harrison Marty Graham was evicted from his apartment on a sweltering August day in 1987 due to obnoxious odors. Inside, the police found the remains of seven women. Graham, 28 years old, first stated that the bodies had been there when he moved in, but then he confessed to having strangled them all accidentally. The first officer to arrive bent down to a keyhole and saw a black woman's naked legs. He knocked and announced himself. With an investigator from the medical examiner's office, he forced the door and entered the fetid room. The nude female on a mattress was deceased. She'd been dead for some time. Next to the mattress on a pile of trash was another female corpse. A homicide detective joined the search team. Around 3:45 p.m., they turned up a third set of remains, wrapped in two sheets and buried under the debris beneath the second body. These were nearly skeletal, but had shreds of clothing. Less than 2 hours later, the searchers turned up a fourth set of mummified remains inside some sheets. The fifth body was found around 5:30, pulled out of another area of debris. But the peculiar detail about this one was that he or she, they couldn't tell, had been sandwiched between two mattresses. The searchers wondered if the evicted tenant had actually slept on the top mattress with the victim underneath, like a dried flower smashed between pages of a book. It appeared as though the tenant had resided in one room and had kept the adjoining room as his own private mausoleum. Another 2 hours went by before a sixth body was located, crammed inside a tiny 6-inch deep closet, sitting up, wrapped in a sheet and tied with white electrical cord. Another decomposed body was found outside the window on the roof. The search was on for the evicted tenant. When he left, Graham had taken a water bottle, some items of clothing, and his raggedy blue Cookie Monster. Investigators learned that Graham was known to take long walks and play basketball with local kids. He liked to entertain them with his Cookie Monster. Other neighbors said he was a loner, but when he got drunk, he'd act a little crazy. He talked to his puppet all the time. Graham was arrested on the streets. He finally confessed to killing the women found in his apartment, but was hazy on the details. He'd accidentally killed them during sex, he admitted, under the influence of drugs. He was full of remorse. Eventually, he went to trial. Among the seized evidence was his Cookie Monster puppet, which he asked to have back. "I sleep with that," he said, but the puppet remains in evidence. Defense attorney Joel Moldovsky had prepared well for his client. It wasn't just insanity, he said. These acts had been due to Graham's multiple personality disorder. Harrison Frank Graham Jr. was presented as having three distinct personalities. Frank was a foul-mouthed drug addict, and murderer Jr. was an unmanageable 2-year-old who adored the Cookie Monster, and Marty was the likable handyman who had complied with the police. Graham chose to have the judge decide his case. Apparently, his attorney and his mother had convinced him that the graphic evidence would strongly offend a jury. The prosecutor offered some powerful witnesses. Two women said they'd lived with Graham and survived, but just barely. One testified that during sex, he would place his hands around her throat and squeeze. Several times, she thought he was killing her. He'd told her, she said, that he'd killed one of his former girlfriends in anger. The second witness confirmed that Graham had confessed to this killing. He'd also threatened her with a machete. Moldovsky asked this witness to pull the crusty Cookie Monster puppet out of a bag of items. She did not want to touch it, but she did admit that he'd chatted with it every day that she'd lived with him. A psychiatrist for the defense said that since Graham said he could not recall the first 5 murders, it was not possible to judge his mental state at the time of those crimes. However, during the last 2 incidents, he'd hallucinated the voices of both God and the devil. Thus, he had been psychotic. It was getting late, but the persistent officers continued to press the detained suspect until finally he admitted that he had played a role in the murders of the 7 women. He had tried for hours to convince the men that the bodies had been there when he'd moved into the complex. Reluctantly, he would admit to one killing, then finally relented and told the whole truth. With a twist, it may have been his hands, but it was not his mind. It was Marty, he explained. "My mama told me to read the Bible, and hell hath no place for sin. But he done these things. I love my Bible, and I hath no place for these things. He done these things." Harrison Graham, 1998, from Harrisburg Penitentiary. When Harrison was a small boy, according to both his own version of his life and more evidentiary, the research of investigators, his familial situation was not always sound. At an early age, he was both the lover to and employee of a male pimp. Troubles at home led him to the streets, where for the first time, Harrison claims to have felt deeply loved. He was introduced to homosexual relationships and prostitution, and also to drugs. In his early teens, his mother's own spiritual revelation was imposed upon him. She dragged him from the streets he'd come to know as home and began to preach the immoralities of his lifestyle, one she'd been utterly involved in for a very long time. Not even the most seasoned psychologists could explain for certain why Harrison Graham became a serial murderer. However, even a layperson could point to specific incidences in his childhood and adolescence that were surely significant in the splitting of his person, that of the loving and rehabilitated Christian son, and conversely, the homosexual addict with an insidious passion for the underbelly of street living. It would only be a matter of time until he would develop a name for this altered state. Once established, All guilt could be carried by one entity, leaving the other person to live a life free of the responsibility of both his perverse sexual needs and drug habits, and ultimately his serial crimes. Nevertheless, the judge found Graham guilty on all counts of first-degree murder and abuse of a corpse. Graham just blinked and shook his head. Moldovsky later told reporters, "I assume he knows he was found guilty, but I'm not sure." Graham asked to have his Cookie Monster back. The sentences were a mix of both life without parole and death. In an unusual move, the judge decided that Graham should not be executed until after he'd served the life sentence. Moldovsky found this ruling to be Solomonic and compassionate. It meant that Graham had received a life sentence without the possibility of parole. However, this sentence went through a round of unusual challenges until the death sentences were vacated in 2003 due to his low IQ and indicators of early onset mental illness. He was considered not competent to be executed. Behind bars, he became an ordained minister. And with that, we've reached the end of this video, all about the Cookie Monster killer, Harrison Frank Graham. If you enjoyed this video and you found it helpful, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe for more content just like this.